Welcome to another episode of Scuba Science. Today we are going to discuss the science behind decompression models. Every time you descend into the underwater world, your body inevitably absorbs gas. Depending on the breathing gas you're using, your body also absorbs nitrogen. And as pressure increases because depth increases, more nitrogen dissolves into your body. Upon ascent, your body does need to be able to release this gas at a comfortable, slow rate to avoid decompression sickness or the bends. Decompression science is all about managing these gas loads. And in order to be able to do that as divers, we need to use what's called decompression models. So let's discuss how these models came to be and what types of models actually exist. If you look below this video, you can also see a join button. It is now possible to become a DiveSAGA member. This is a great way to support the DiveSAGA channel or Scuba Science specifically. And if you become an all access member, you also get access to, amongst other perks, the Scuba Science scripts in case you want to do some reading after watching the video. Today's episode is sponsored by the Underwater Club. The Underwater Club is a fully online underwater photography academy. It's designed to make learning underwater photography easier and fully online. And right now, already participants from 18 different countries are studying and interacting together on this platform. I checked it out myself and it's actually really smart. It has very short, nice online modules on various topics and you can study at your own pace. But that's not all. The courses are created by Nicolas Remy, who is actually an award-winning underwater photographer, and he offers the option to do online Q&A sessions, and you can even have your own photos checked and critiqued by Nicolas himself. So besides studying online, you are getting mentorship from a real award-winning underwater photographer. I made an account myself and I highly recommend you look into it too, especially if you're looking to get into underwater photography or want to get better. There is a coupon code DiveSAGA with which you can get a 10% discount on the Underwater Club, and you can also take a free trial if you're not super sure. But thank you to the Underwater Club for sponsoring this episode of Scuba Science. The first structured decompression theory came from Dr. John Scott Haldane in the early 1900s. Haldane proposed that the human body could be modeled after separate compartments that absorb and release inert gases at a different rate. These compartments aren't necessarily supposed to represent actual body parts, but their nature of on-gassing and off-gassing at different speeds are in line with what different parts of our body does. His work for the Royal Navy actually led to the first staged decompression tables. The first tables were conservative and based on empirical data. Over time, as diving matured into scientific and recreational diving, the US Navy, the NOAA, and organizations such as Divers Alert Network all started producing their own tables based on real-world field data. These were constructed by using actual dives, chamber dives, using Doppler ultrasound measurements, and mathematical modeling. All of these advancements have led to the existence of the tables that we know and use today. But it is important to understand that this is still science in progress. At the heart of all these decompression models lies the concept of tissue compartments. Once again, these tissue compartments aren't meant to be actual one-on-one representations of parts of the human body, but they produce the same idea. Different parts of the body absorb and release gases at different rates. That's important because us as humans, our body does not absorb and release gas on a single time scale. This is why decompression sickness can manifest itself in specific parts of the body. And that makes sense, because different parts of the body have different density and different access to circulation, and therefore are going to react differently when coming into contact with certain amounts of inert gas. Each of these compartments is then defined by a half-time. A half-time is essentially the amount of time it takes for 50% of that compartment to be saturated. So, for example, fast tissues like the lungs or blood may have a half-time of 5 to 10 minutes. Let's say 10 minutes, which would mean that it takes 10 minutes at a given depth for that tissue compartment to be halfway saturated, and another 10 minutes for the remaining half of that tissue to be halfway saturated, and another 10 minutes for the remaining half of that tissue to be halfway saturated, and so on. Most models use 8 to 16 compartments to simulate the different body tissues. And the compartment with the highest tissue supersaturation at a given moment will become the controlling compartment. In other words, that compartment is going to control the off-gassing protocol. To prevent bubble formation, we then need a limit of how much gas a certain tissue can absorb before it becomes unsafe to ascend to the surface immediately. These limits are called M values, which is short for maximum allowable inert gas pressure. Each tissue compartment will have its own individual M value dependent on the ambient pressure. In other words, each compartment reacts differently depending on the pressure to which it is exposed. If your nitrogen levels stay below that limit, then the decompression is considered safe. Once again, this is very theoretical and is not a direct representation of your body. Traditional dive tables are static and box-shaped, meaning that they were only really able to model a dive with a descent to a given depth, then a constant time at that one specific depth, and a singular ascent. For instance, 60 feet, 18 meters for 50 minutes with no variations in depth. So these models didn't really account for instance, multi-level diving or stops during the ascent. Luckily, we now live in the era of dive computers, and dive computers have changed this box-shaped profile that we used to dive with before. Specifically, the algorithms in those dive computers are what truly changed the game. Instead of following a grid-based singular box-shaped table, these computers are able to track our position and our actual depth in the water at any given moment. So step by step, the computer can actually analyze at which depth we are and take that into account for our overall diving profile and thus for our overall decompression obligations. In other words, dive computers write a custom dive table for that specific dive. Different dive computers will use different algorithms, but it is safe to say that there are two main diving decompression algorithms popularly being used today. The first one would be the Buhlmann algorithm. This is an algorithm that allows for adjustment through the use of gradient factors. You may have seen that GF conservatism setting in your dive computer, and in broad strokes, it is generally characterized by stopping shallower but longer. I am generalizing, and there are ways to modify your Buhlmann algorithm and to bend the curve to your liking. Then there is RGBM, or Reduced Gradient Bubble Model. This includes bubble dynamics and microbubble control. RGBM is generally known for allowing for deeper, longer dives while still reducing the risk of decompression sickness. And it focuses on minimizing the difference between the surrounding pressure and the gas pressure in the body's tissues, which generally results in stops that will start a little bit deeper. And while maybe less common than Buhlmann and RGBM, other decompression algorithms do exist, such as, for instance, the Talman model or the variable permeability model, or VPM. All these different models essentially have different approaches to how they will calculate our gas exposure and our off-gassing. In essence, the choice of decompression model will influence dive planning, time spent underwater, and time spent ascending. And it is also worth knowing that some computer manufacturers will have proprietary models that only they use for their dive computers. Either way, it is somewhat important to understand the model that your computer is using and what its main characteristics are. Earlier, I mentioned gradient factors when discussing the Buhlmann model. Gradient factors are a way of tweaking the conservatism of the Buhlmann model. As I mentioned earlier, the Buhlmann model tends to start stopping a little bit shallower and tends to then spend or have you spend a longer time at the shallower depths. Gradient factor settings consist of two numbers, gradient factor low and gradient factor high. Gradient factor low will essentially determine how deep your first stop will actually start. Gradient factor high will essentially determine at which amount of saturation you will be allowed to surface. So for instance, a gradient factor 30-85 means that the first stop will occur when a tissue reaches 30% of its M value, and you will surface at no more than 85%. More conservative divers might use 20-70, and maybe more aggressive divers might use 45-90. I am in no way suggesting or endorsing any specific gradient factor settings. I'm just giving examples of how these two numbers will influence the dive's conservatism. You should always consult with your diving instructor and, of course, err on the side of conservatism. But at least now we understand that gradient factors, by using those two numbers, control the shape of the curve and therefore determine what our profile is going to look like. For years, many divers believed in deep stops, and some still do today, although less so. The idea behind deep stops is essentially to insert stops in the deep portions of the dive to limit bubble formation. Some dive computers encouraged this or automatically prompted them, especially those using RGBM or VPM models like we discussed earlier. However, recent research, including by renowned institutes such as DAN and the Navy Experimental Diving Unit, suggests that including too many deep stops actually has adverse effects, because it will cause decompression stress in slower tissues. In other words, we might still be on-gassing certain tissues rather than off-gassing. So, ironically, inserting too many deep stops could cause DCS rather than prevent it. Today, many instructors, and especially technical diving instructors, might actually prefer a more balanced profile that is somewhere in the middle, meaning they might use a Buhlmann algorithm, but with conservative gradient factors, so not immediately ascending as shallow as the algorithm might allow it, and staying a little longer than what the algorithm might suggest. But again, every instructor and every technical diver will probably have their own reasons and their own preference based on their experience. Lastly, it is super important to realize that decompression models are just that. They are mathematical models that attempt to give a representation of the real world, but in no way do they give an actual readout of the actual state of being of any given diver on any given dive. There are many other factors that actually influence our susceptibility to decompression sickness. For instance, cold water. Diving in cold water slows circulation and therefore slows off-gassing, which means that you will increase your risk of decompression sickness and might choose to use a more conservative setting. Increased exercise at depth, for instance a more complicated mission, also alters circulation and might also prompt you to reduce your gradient factors or to lower your conservatism settings. Dehydration is a very known cause of decompression sickness and should also be taken into account, although hydrating a lot before and after a dive is always smart. Fatigue, illness, or age do also factor in, as they all have an influence on our circulation. Again, anything that basically affects your body's circulation is something to take into account for your dive planning. Repetitive dives obviously need to be factored in, and most models will have planning modes that allow for this. And lastly, there is also the ascent rate. Most models will work with a variable ascent rate, meaning you, the end user, can determine how fast or how slow you want to ascend between stops. This will be factored in to the overall decompression calculation. But it is also important to then execute those ascent rates as designed. In conclusion, dive tables and diving algorithms may sound like very abstract math, but they do their best to approximate what the human body is going through on a scuba dive. Understanding the decompression models that you use is going to empower you as a diver and is going to help you to execute your dives in the safest possible way. But again, it is also important to realize that decompression science is not a definitive science. We have not figured it all out yet. It is very much one of the many ways that we are still constantly making new discoveries and improvements in scuba science.